Part four of buying a John Deere garden tractor or lawn tractor or mower. Part four is how to buy. So we're going to separate this, or I have separated this into three parts. The search for and research of your new to you or new machine. What should I pay? Some of my tips there. And then what do I look for in the machines you're looking at use? So we'll start off with the searching and research. Probably one of the most common mistakes I see is somebody types in like a Google search and they look for a lawnmower. And also another common mistake is you just go down to the big box store and you buy the biggest, baddest thing they have there, which is not big and bad by any stretch of the imagination, and you think it's going to do the work of a X7 series. But for the most part, what people do is they go and you type something into Google or you type something into Craigslist. And so you start off with Craigslist, and I'm just going to abbreviate Craigslist as CL. Or you go to eBay and you do a search. Well, what is that going to yield you? That's going to yield you overpriced machines. Any type of searching like that. All right. Now, also, and I'm assuming that the research, you're going to have to do the research on your own. I'm not going to comment too much about research, but I would encourage you to use forums and online information there. Maybe even get on eBay, buy a couple of, pay $5 or $6 for some older brochures if you're after an old machine. That's about all I'm going to say about research. But searching for them, a lot of people, they go to Craigslist or eBay, and all they see is overpriced machines. They see the 2012s. This is a recent example that I saw, a 2012 John Deere X749, so a diesel all-wheel steer X machine, 300 and some odd hours with the 47 snowblower, and the seller's asking $12,500. That's just not realistic. You can buy a new machine. I mean, granted, you can't get an X759, but you can buy a new machine for almost less than that, even with the snowblower, depending on what you need. It's just not, a lot of sellers, they think because it's diesel or it's not offered anymore or something's new come out, I get the impression that some sellers, they want their money back, and you're not going to get it. It's a used machine at that point. But all you're going to find in these searches are overpriced machines, particularly with Craigslist, all right? Craigslist, in this case, is all you're going to find is machines that don't sell. As soon as something sells on Craigslist, the seller will go to the ad, remove the ad from the site, and it no longer shows up. So all the machine, all the 425s and the 445s and the 455s that are $5,000, $6,000, $7,000, the reason they're still there is because they're not selling. Look at how old an ad is. If an ad's 2 months old and the John Deere 445 is $6,500, that's just not realistic for its age. So all you're going to find here is overpriced machines. However, if you do an eBay sold search, you can find sold machines, and you will actually find the price they sell for. I would encourage you to look at auctions instead of just buy it nows, because sometimes buy it nows are driven by location, time of year, stuff like that. But the problem with eBay sold stuff is you're only going to see the last about 60 days, maybe 90, depending on how fast it gets removed off the site. So it's not all that common. You can't get a long-term track of prices there. Obviously, you have all the equipment sites. So you have the auction and regular equipment sites, so like Machine Finder, Purple Wave, Auction Time. Stuff like that. You can find machines there, and then also papers. A lot of gas stations, convenience stores, stuff like that. You will find papers, like just print papers where they'll sell machines and stuff like that. Auction Time has some nice papers or books out there by region. And that will help there. Also, something else that goes into the searching and researching. Common phrase I see. I see this all the time in my area, and it's generally followed by, well, I'm not going to find anything that cheap in my area. Everything's always so expensive. That is driven by this. When you're searching on Craigslist, when you say, not in my area, everything's so expensive, that's because everybody is looking at these prices. They're not looking at sold. They're not looking at equipment sites, so auctions that have been sold, like on Purple Wave and stuff. They're not looking where those things have been sold there, and they're not looking papers. You're not going to find a whole lot of sold things, but this is a common mistake. From one side of this country to the other, there should not be, sure, there's some, I'll call dead zones for machines, but shipping these machines is not that expensive. There's no reason that a John Deere X485 should be $2,000 more in one area than the other, one geographic location than the other, because for the most part, it's only going to cost $500 or $600 to ship it. So, or go pick it up. I mean, you think about it, if you're going to save $2,000, if you have a SUV or something like that, you can go rent a U-Haul trailer and you can go pick it up. I mean, you can drive, you can spend a weekend going to pick it up, take a day off work on a Friday, and it's not going to be that, I mean, you're going to save quite a bit of money. So in my area is probably one of my biggest pet peeves, because realistically, it just, there's not that much difference in price. Now, when you get into larger, you know, ag tractors and stuff like that, sure, this is going to change a little bit. But for lawn and garden tractors, it's just not that big of a deal. You know, there's just not that big a price difference. So one of the things that I just kind of want to emphasize with this section right here is you need to compare sold versus still listed. If you're looking at a machine and you're trying to you know, figure out what you need to pay for it, and all you can find on Craigslist is overpriced garbage, then that's probably what you're looking at. For instance, I think previously on a Craigslist I was searching, there was a John Deere, and I'm just going to use this as an example. There was a John Deere X475, so carbureted X series. It was on Craigslist for almost 2.5 years at $5,500. I have no earthly idea what happened to it. The machine itself was probably worth $2,500 or $3,000 based on its condition, and it just didn't move. The seller wasn't willing to come down, so it just sits there. So if you watch Craigslist, you know, do daily Craigslist searches, not just once a week, because if you just do it once a week, then you're not going to find what you need. Now, it takes a lot of work to do all of this research, and it takes time, energy, effort. It takes it all, but in the end, you'll get a better deal. Now, if you find something local that you really like and it's what's for you, then hey, go for it. So that's searching and the research. I talked briefly about research, mostly just searching. Next is, what should I pay? What you should pay, probably the biggest piece of advice, and people are always wondered about, they're always worried about getting swindled out of extra money and stuff. If you're happy with your purchase, that's all that matters. I have a number of vintage machines that I probably overpaid twice of what they're worth, but guess what? I really liked them. They were close to my house. I went and saw them, talked to the folks selling them. They had some nice history. They came with a couple things. I mean, this is, you're getting into collecting here, but you know, I'm fine overpaying. You know, I bought one of my 110s. I paid $1,500 for it in a Model 80 cart. And the 110 itself may be worth $500, and the Model 80 cart may be worth, because it's a low serial number, maybe worth $500. But I overpaid by $500 because it was in such great condition. So if you're happy with it, and I have no complaints about what I paid for that setup. And if you're happy with it, that's all that matters. But if you want to do your due diligence, couple your searches with what you should pay here. Now, one important thing to realize is where you buy it from. Private versus dealer. This is going to affect the sales price greatly. Dealers are obviously in this to make money. They have overhead. So, you know, if you're buying from a dealer and you're trading something in, guess what? You know, you're gonna take it on the, you're gonna take some loss on the trade, and you're gonna take some loss by paying a little bit more with buying the machine from the dealer. Whereas private, obviously, they're not gonna probably take, they're most likely not gonna take a trade, and also you're gonna pay a little bit less for the machine because they're most likely trying to sell it just to get out from underneath it or get it out of the garage. You know, so it's one of those deals that whatever you want to do. Obviously, private, you have less recourse to do anything if there's something wrong with it. I mean, the dealer, you're pretty much in the same boat if you're buying used. Obviously, if you're buying new, that's going to come with some benefits. That's up to you. Now, what you should pay, you know, and I'm going to lump what you should pay into what do I look for, kind of do both of them at the same time. But, you know, take your time. Do your research. Don't fly into things half-witted. Don't get all emotional at an auction. If you go to and you buy these things in an auction, I guarantee you if there is a single, almost every case I've been to, if there is a single John Deere lawn tractor or lawn and garden tractor or garden tractor at auction, it will almost always go higher than if you were buying it somewhere else. Can't tell you the number of auctions I've been to where I have watched two or three folks just get into a bidding war and end up paying, you know, 50% or even double what something's, you know, typically what I would say worth. Probably the most egregious example is one time I watched I think it was a 235 sell for almost $2,200, and all it had was a snowblower, and they cranked it up during the auction. It was a fancy mosquito fogger. I mean, literally, this thing smoked like a freight train. It was in terrible shape, but $2,200 later, it was sold, and I just shook my head. It was amazing. But do your research. Don't get caught up in emotions. There's more machines. You know, these machines are out there. Be patient. You know, know what you can afford, know what you can pay, and just be ready to jump when the opportunity presents itself. Goes back to this down here in my area. Well, in the Craigslist searches. Well, guess what? Like I said, all those Craigslist searches that you do, if you do Craigslist searches often enough, you'll find the machines that sell and you can get one. Obviously, like I said, it takes a lot of time. Now, one thing I think it's really important to realize is, you know, these new X, and I'm just going to use X series, new X series are $12,000, $13,000 for the most time, tax, tag, title, whatever, fees out the door, with decks and whatever, you know, $12,000, $13,000 plus. Well, why would you go buy a year-old machine for $10,000? Yeah, it sure still has the warranty, or $11,000, when you can go buy a new one for, you know, $1,000 or $2,000 more. You get the full warranty. It's brand new to you. You know, folks overbuy all the time. You know, use that to your advantage, but there's no reason to go paying, you know, $10,000 or $11,000 for a year-old machine. Simply, you know, you drive it off the lot, you lose a lot of value, and there's no reason for you to go paying that much. Same thing with a little bit older machines. You know, there's no reason. A lot of times I see folks trying to sell 300 and 400 series from the 80s and early 90s for as much as you can get for a 445 or a 455. And they say because they're old and good and vintage technology and everything. I'll take a new machine any day of the week when it comes to actually doing work. Okay, they're plastic, but guess what? You know, you can fix the plastic, you can get over it, be nice to it. And in terms of ergonomics, comfort, and speed, I'll take my X748 any day of the week over a 430. That's just based on usage. I mean, I use my machines hard. You know, I piled 100 and some odd hours on my 1445 this summer or this past year, and, you know, I'll pile another, I think I piled 150 hours on the X748 this year. You know, I put lots of hours on my machine. That's machines. That's why I don't want old ones. The new ones are better, regardless of what some people say. So we're going to kind of, you know, what do you pay? That's up to you. Use common sense. Don't overpay. Or at least I would encourage you not to. I've seen lots of guys do it. So what do I look for? So this video doesn't get too long. You know, be concerned about maintenance. You want to make sure about maintenance. Battery. Batteries are expensive little things. So when people say, oh, the battery doesn't come with it, it's like, I'm sorry, you know, you don't want a battery to come with it. Well, if anybody's priced a battery lately, if it's a non-lawn and garden battery, you can spend $60-$70 on a battery nowadays. Oil filter. I always find it interesting, both oil and trans, if you're looking at a hydraulic machine or hydro machine. The oil filters and trans filters always tell an interesting story. I cannot tell you of the number of machines that I have purchased that have a two-legged leaping deer trans filter. That means that Deere got rid of that emblem in 2000, and so say there was dealer holdover on those filters until 2004. You know, say there was supply. Well, that means that, I mean, it's now 2017, so say it sat around on the shelf for another 3 years at a guy's house, and that's 10 years since the fluid's been changed. Same thing with the oil filters. I can't tell you how many two-legged oil filters I've found on machines. You know, use lots of little clues like that. And then notice where the dirt and grime is at. Dirt and grime are huge. You know, it's a good indication of where a leak is at or a leak has been. Goes back to maintenance. There's nothing more concerning to me is when I come up and look at a machine and it has been pressure washed the day before and it is pristine. That concerns me greatly. What are you trying to hide as a seller? Anytime I sell my machines, I'll clean off the outside, you know, the dust and whatnot. But for the most part, I will leave the engine compartment and everything else the way it is. You know, that's just the way you see it. You know, look underneath the machine, make sure there's no oil spots where the machine is parked. It should be cold. So when you start it, you know, you don't want, I've seen some sellers before, you know, the machines have a hard time starting, and they'll go out there and they'll start it up before I get there, and then it's warm when I get there, and it starts real easy, but it'll be a problem. Also, one of the big things is all of these things cost money. So if it's done beforehand, you know, that's all the better. But don't fall for, one of the biggest things I fall for is, you know, they'll list it as fresh fluids plugs and filters. This goes back to the filters here. They'll change the oil filter, but they won't change the trans filter. What they'll do is they'll drop the trans oil out, and then they'll just put new trans oil back in there, not change the filter. I've seen that done before. And sure, these things cost money, but they're super easy to do, and that doesn't warrant you paying an extra $1,000 on a $5,000 machine just because it's had service done. You know, you can get you can do the service yourself for $250, maybe $300 for most of these tractors that I'm talking about. So, you know, don't fall for this too hard. Certainly a concern. If you see this in an ad, most likely those people are flippers. They're, you know, they bought it cheap, trying to sell high. There's several of them in every county, I think. And you know, hey, if you don't have the time to do it, maybe you're gonna have to buy from a flipper, but that's up to you. But these kind of things concern me when I see them in ads. If they have maintenance records, that's always fantastic. Maintenance records are always good. I bought a couple machines with maintenance records, and it always makes me feel good. Bought my 1445 that you've seen in some of my videos, even though it's a front mount. We really haven't talked about those. It came with maintenance records up till 1,500 hours or so, and it had 2,000 hours on it when I bought it. It's a former municipal machine. Made me feel a whole lot better about the machine itself, you know, that had been maintained, even though it wasn't necessarily perfect cosmetically. But anyway, before this video becomes too long, so these are some of the things that I look for, what I would suggest you look for, how to buy. do your search and do all your research, you know, get on forums, look on online for information about the machines after you figured out what you want. You know, do sold searches. Don't just use Craigslist and eBay. Anybody can ask any price for a machine. There's no, you know, nobody's going to stop anybody from listing a machine at, you know, $20,000. I mean, people might poke and laugh, but, or point and laugh, but, you know, it's not going to stop them. You know, use eBay sold searches, equipment sites. Stay away from this one right here in my area. It's more expensive. Your area is not really all that unique. Like I said, there are some dry zones, but they're not very common. You know, private versus dealer, you gotta decide what you want to do there. Obviously, dealers are a little bit easier to work with. Do your research on that. And then what I look for, you want to be concerned about maintenance. You know, battery because it's so expensive, trans filters, dirt and grime, you know, how the engine behaves, stuff like that. So anyway, hope that helps. That's the end of the four-part series. I may add to these at a later date. If they help, great. If not, well, I tried. So anyway, thanks for watching.